So thank you, Ashna, for being here today for the interview. So the first question, could you tell us a little bit about yourself? Tell us about your current position and your academic background.
Okay, well, just to introduce myself, my name is Ashna. I'm a junior process engineer with Greenlane Biogas, which is an RNG or green energy company based out of Burnaby. In school, I went to UBC and I studied chemical engineering with a focus in process. And I also did a minor in arts, which was really fun. now I work in industry. So this is the same job that I did as soon as I graduated. And it's actually with the company that I did my capstone project with, which is really awesome. And it just shows you how important networking can be. So that's a little bit about
me. That's awesome. So moving on to the second question, what is a typical day at work for you as a process engineer?
Okay, so I think, and this is probably true for a lot of design engineers, is that your typical day will change a lot depending on where you are in a project cycle. So if you're in the design phase, a lot of your day might be, you know, specifying equipment or making process flow diagrams, just kind of getting the like blueprint of a system ready. And then as you move through a project cycle into commissioning or like aftercare, so a plant is already done and now you're having issues with the plant, your day will look very different. In my case, we have lots of projects going on and they're all at different stages of the cycle. So my day can be very mixed. And it always starts, especially in the age of COVID, with a morning meeting call just to make sure that everybody's on the same page, especially when we can't see each other physically. So I'll start my day, I'll have some emails, take care of like lots of little questions that I might have from other departments, and then we'll have our morning meeting. And this is where you really set the stage of like, okay, these are the urgent issues of the day. This is a problem that's happening and who can solve it. So then we move on to the next stage, which is like, I will work towards solving that problem. You'll have lots of other meetings on the subject. You know, oftentimes we have like a couple of meetings a day about suppliers or designing new projects. And then, you know, as far as design work goes, as a process engineer, I really like, and it is my job to make process and instrumentation diagrams. This is something that we don't really see very much of until I think third or fourth year of chemical engineering, but they're basically like two-dimensional diagrams of the system. So you as a mechanical engineer will actually take this diagram and you will turn it into a SolidWorks model or like equipment. And it's like very interesting to see the difference between the two, because a process and instrumentation diagram, they're all symbols and they're like built for a user to understand how like media or gas flows through a system. And like, this is the one base document from which electrical and mechanical engineers go forth to do the rest of the job, which is building into actuality. And that diagram is so different from what comes out as the final mechanical product. Because, you know, in the diagram, you might have one line that goes from here to here, but the physical pipe might go like up and down and around, which is really cool to me. And so a lot of my day will be building those diagrams and then working with mechanical and electrical engineers to see, you know, does it include all the components that we need? Should I move things around so it makes more sense in the physical model? And that's what a lot of my day is, yeah.
That is awesome. So when you're in undergrad and when you're choosing your career path, what does chemical and biological engineering sit out for you? And what makes you decide on pursuing it?
So this might not be a good answer. I really didn't know what I wanted to do. So that's why I really liked that at UBC, we had 1 year where you got a little bit of everything. And I basically picked the one that was easiest for me. So my natural inclination was towards chemical engineering. I'm really bad with circuits. I'm really bad with physics. And so mechanical engineering and electrical were just out. At the time, I mean, I know this is changing a lot more now, but computer engineering, we didn't really have programming classes in high school. So while I really liked it, I wasn't familiar with what, you know, that could be and what like that would be like. So chemical engineering felt a lot more comfortable to me. I did think that it would have a lot more actual chemistry involved, and it actually doesn't. A lot of chemical engineering is mostly thermodynamics, which you will also be very familiar with, and a lot of like calculus. But it's cool because, I mean, that's applied science, so it's not specifically chemistry, but It's, you know, how can you make the reaction happen as fast as possible? How can you make sure that you have like a catalyst that works really well with the system? So it's cool. It is a cool process, but I picked what was easiest.
That is also really good. Moving on, what are three habits or skills necessary for highly successful engineers?
So I did think about this a little bit because mm-hmm. a little bit of forewarning, but I think that basically it all comes down to the teamwork, and that might be, mm-hmm. you know, a lot for my team because we work in a small team of multidisciplinary engineers, but I think these three things will just basically mean you have to be good at teamwork. So I think one is you have to have a lot of respect for other people and other people's right. time, especially. So respect and then valuing other people's time. Those are two separate things. But like, you know, in an engineering team, I kind of mentioned we're working on lots of projects and they're all at different phases. You'll get people asking you from procurement or from PMs a lot of different priorities, and they'll all say like, we want it immediately, right? So your plate might be full, and at the same time, you need to get other people to help approve your work, especially at our stage in our careers, right? Mm-hmm. You might need to, you know, ask people for their assistance with things, or in general, just like book meetings with everyone in a room so you can talk it out. And everyone else's plate is just as full as yours. So you have to have a lot of respect for other people in terms of, you know, they have a lot more experience than you do, but also for their time. So if someone pushes back and says like, I can't do this, you know, you really have to understand. And I think that's something about being a good teammate. That's also something you learn in school when you say like, oh, right. we really work on this project. And it's like, well, I have 5 midterms. So school will prepare you for that, but it, keep it in mind. Especially if you work with different departments, you might not be able to see them all the time. In the age of COVID, you can't really see anybody. So I don't know what they're working on, but you just have to trust that they are busy if they say they're busy. And I think like another part of that is also to stay humble. So no one knows everything. Like as a student, I definitely thought I knew everything, but I don't. And you know, like exams taught me that very quickly. But I also think that it's important to realize like, you know, if you're talking to a supplier and you don't understand something, you can ask them. They have so much experience and they're happy to share. And I think that stands true for like everybody that you work with. So it's really important to recognize like the talent that other people have and you know, ask mm-hmm. questions, but also never assume that you know everything, because you probably don't, you know, like until we're like, we've been working in an industry for 20, 30 years, we'll always be learning something new.
Right. Yeah, for sure. For sure. Those are some really good advice. Thank you. If you could give one piece of advice for your student self, what would it be?
One piece of advice. I think I did mention this like just before maybe, but I think that you really need to trust your profs. Like I not trust my profs as much as I should have into like actually believing that what we are learning is important. It's really easy again to get tied up in like, I just need to learn this for an exam, but trust that they're doing you for a reason. Like the course and the program credited for a reason, because everything is important to learn and you will probably use it. Like, I mean, I know a lot of people say like they didn't use like everything they learned in university. I actually use like things that I directly learned from my courses throughout my day. And so like, I think that, you know, yeah, you should just believe them.
That's a good advice. I'll keep that in mind.
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah. So just to wrap up, what is your favorite part about being an engineer?
My favorite part? I think it's probably getting to work with lots of different people. I'm a really extroverted person. And so I really enjoy that. Like, you know, that was one of the attractive elements to if I become a doctor, like I would get to work with patients all day. That's definitely also still in an engineering role. Like, you know, you get to work with clients, with project managers, suppliers, your sales team, procurement team. Like there's so many people in your day-to-day life that it keeps things exciting and you get to solve problems. So it's not like every day is the same, which is great.
That is awesome. That's very good to hear. Well, thank you so much for doing this interview with me and sharing your experience. That has been really helpful. So I'm sure all the other students would definitely benefit from there. So I'm just going to